Go ahead and have a
seat. Amen. What a great worship set. Thanks, team. Man, be able to focus on who the Lord is and to talk about his promise and to talk about the fact that he promises us so very much and he fulfills his promise. That's the key that we're able to celebrate today, that he does what he says he is going to do. Today, our focus is on the topic of assurance of salvation. Over these past few weeks, we've talked about life in view of eternity, what that means for us. We've talked about, Pastor Nate led us through thinking about hell and how real that is, the reality of it, and the fact that there are people around us, people who are not going to follow Christ, haven't known about Christ, need to be told about Jesus, that unless they have a life transformation, will spend eternity in hell. We do not want that for anyone that we know or for anyone we don't know, by the way. We just don't want that for any person. Last week, Pastor Nate talked about heaven and the importance of how that is and the reality of it and how we can be a part of heaven and what that means and praying for those around us, praying for others who need to be transformed. Today, we end the series talking about what it means to have assurance of salvation. What it means to recognize and to know that we are assured of our salvation. Now, it has many terms that's often used with it. You might hear someone talk about perseverance of the saints, right? The saints are going to persevere until the end. And the Bible would teach that concept of perseverance of the saint. Others would talk about it being eternal security, so that in eternity we have security, right? So we are eternal, our eternal life is secure. Others might use the phrase, once saved, and always saved. You've heard that phrase before. It simply means that inside those three different phrases that I just used, all of them have pretty much the same meaning. There are some nuances in all those things and the theology that goes along with all three of those phrases. But in reality, I think our question that we most often ask is, how do I know that my salvation is secure? Or, really in another way, can I lose my salvation? Now, we ask that question maybe for our own lives, maybe whether you're in the room or online, you have friends that you know or family members that you know or people around you who would say to you, well, I used to be a Christian or I was saved or I was baptized, but now I've given that up. I've let go of that. I'm not a Christian anymore. And for us, we ask the question, is that a possibility? How does that really work? Can we lose our salvation? Now, my simple answer to that out of the chute is no, we cannot. Salvation is not something that we can lose. Now, I hope in these next few minutes I want to show you from God's word and the reality of why that is true, not just a statement of saying no, but how do we back that up? What comes along with the truth of that so that when you're talking to someone or when you are dealing with it yourself, that there is a truth in the fact that our salvation is secure. Now, all of us in the room know people who have walked through struggles. All of us in the room know people, probably ourselves included, who have fallen, who have gone through something, and we have fallen in the midst of temptation, we have fallen in the midst of sin, that we were living a Christian life and got off the path. Many of us understand that. Many of us have done that. Now, oftentimes you might hear someone say they fell from grace. Well, that's not what the Bible teaches. You can't fall from grace, because grace is something that you didn't purchase on your own. That's why it becomes a fundamental, foundational truth of God's word, that we are secure in our salvation. And we're going to talk more about that as we walk through scripture to look at that. If you have your Bible with you, if you have your iPad or a phone or whatever you might have that you're looking at, I hope you'll take that out, because we're going to look at several scriptures. We're going to start with Romans chapter 5. We're going to start in Romans chapter 5. Paul gives us a great understanding of what it means to have salvation. He gives us an understanding that if we have salvation, it is the work of what Christ has done, and that's what we're going to talk about. In Romans chapter 5, the first five verses of what we're going to look at today as a jumping off point. We'll be looking at a few other scriptures as we go along. In order to help us to understand that your salvation, how you understand your life in Christ, is secure. Those around you, They have a life in Christ that is secure in Christ. Now, when Paul begins talking in Romans chapter 5, he really starts the first verse of Romans chapter 5, or the first word, he says, therefore. Well, when you see the word therefore, you always ask the question, what's it there for, right? What did he say that led him to say therefore? All of chapter 4, Paul has been trying to help us to understand that this promise of our salvation comes by faith. It is the fact that we have faith in Christ, of what Christ has done. The fact that Jesus, the gospel, died on the cross for our sin, paid the penalty for my sin. And dying on the cross then, he died and was buried, and he rose from the dead. And we have faith in that. We place our faith in that. Paul has talked about that in chapter 4. At the end of chapter 4, if you want to look at the very last verse of chapter 4, he says, talking about Jesus, who was delivered up for our trespasses and raised for our justification. We used that word a couple of times already today. That idea of justification, that we have been justified in Christ, means that we are no longer guilty of the sin in our life because Christ has paid that penalty. Now, that is a big deal. There is a lot inside of that for us as a follower of Christ. That is a big deal for us because with that, without him justifying us, without him taking our guilt away, we would be guilty of sin. And the Bible says that the wages, the payment for sin is death. But we understand, as we do in chapter 4, that Christ has paid that penalty for our sin. Therefore, he says at the beginning of chapter 5. So if you have that text, we'll look at that together. Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, there's that word again, we have been justified by faith, we have been made right with God, we have been moved away from our guilt to be right with God, and we've done that by our faith, okay? We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into his grace in which we stand, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only that, but we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Now that is, as I said already, the foundational passage for a message and a conversation about what it means to have assurance in Christ. I take the bulk of that from what he tells us here in these words when he tells us in verse 3, not only that we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, endurance character, and character produces hope. So let's start talking about this understanding of assurance of salvation. Where does it come from? Assurance of salvation, first of all, is found, as we see in this passage, is found in the endurance of our faith. That's where we find it. He's talking about our faith that's growing, our faith that is in Christ, our faith that is moving forward. The word endurance is not an unusual word for us. We understood that we need to be enduring in all the things around us. So he would say that the assurance of our salvation is as we are, as believers, enduring in our faith, being able to recognize where our faith comes from and walk through that. Now, in these verses, he tells us that we are justified, right? We are the ones who are set free because of our faith, and we are enduring in that. He would tell us the content of our endurance is justification. The content of your endurance of salvation is justification in Christ. There's nothing you did or I did in order to be justified. It was a gift of God. It's what God, through Christ, has done for us. Now, it's not a New Testament concept. So oftentimes, we think of assurance as only a New Testament concept, but the content of assurance of salvation is the whole Bible. Matter of fact, one verse, I could do several, but one verse, Jeremiah 32, 39 through 40, he helps us to understand that in that verse. He says, I will give them one heart and one way. and they may fear me forever for their own good and the good of their children after them. I will make them an everlasting covenant that I will not turn away from doing good to them. That everlasting covenant is the same kind of phrase that Jesus uses with his disciples at the Last Supper. He's talking with them, and he said, this blood is a new covenant. It is a covenant that's everlasting. So from the very parts of the Old Testament, we could do, like I said, we could look at several Bible verses, but the idea of assurance of our salvation is found because the covenant relationship that we have with God and with Jesus. Jesus made that covenant relationship very clear for us. I wish we had a lot of time to talk about what it means to be in that covenant relationship. Jeremiah just helps us to understand that that's where we are. And the content of our assurance is found in the very understanding of the covenant relationship that we have with Jesus. That's why we can say with great certainty that there is assurance of salvation that comes along with that. So because the content of endurance is important, as is the certainty of your endurance. You need to be able to walk out of the room today or to turn off the computer or TV and say, I have a confidence in the certainty of my assurance of salvation. Because, as he would tell us, it is not based on who we are, it is based on what Christ has done for us to justify us. 1 John chapter 2, verse 5 and 6 also helps us with that. He says, but whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Right? You hear that phrase? That we know. It's a knowledge, it's a certainty that we are in him. The Spirit himself, he's talked about that here in chapter 5, the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Right? There's not a question about that in this text. John is not saying that you might be children of God. That could happen that way. He is saying, no, you are children of God. There is a certainty that is inside this passage. And that's important for us to know. Whoever says he's able to walk in the same in which we walk, the Spirit himself is bearing witness to us. Well, at the end of chapter 5, at this very end passage in verse 5, he says that through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us, see, the work of the Spirit brings about the certainty of our salvation. Let's go to the second thing I'd want to say. Again, looking at verse 3, that we rejoice in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character. Assurance of salvation is demonstrated in the character of your faith. Now, in this passage in Romans 5, Paul, if you look at verse 1, says, therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God. Well, that's an incredible word in that passage. If you have a pen, you might want to actually circle that word, because that character of who we are comes out of the peace that we have with Christ. He tells us that very clearly in this passage as he helps us to understand that we have peace with God. That peace comes not because we have done certain things or because we do a certain amount of works. The peace comes through Jesus Christ. He is the one who is doing the work for us, right? He is the one who has accomplished, the one who has justified us. So the understanding that in this, that if we're going to have peace, our life is going to be centered in that peace. Let's ask the simple question. In your life, as a believer, do you have peace about your salvation? That's an easy question for you, and I would answer it this way. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you have great peace and great assurity. Sometimes you think, man, I don't know what's going on. Is this temptation happening? Is this failure happening in my life? I know that to be the case. So if we're going to base our life on feeling, we're going to be in trouble, right? If we're going to base our salvation on today I feel like I'm saved, today I've done something and today I don't feel like I'm saved, we're going to be in deep trouble with that. Paul's view is, no, we understand the peace that comes about our life through Jesus Christ. Now, it's not the emotional peace that we're talking about here. It's the reality of the peace that is found in Jesus. Is your peace found in Christ? Or is your peace found in works? Is your peace found in how you perform and how you are evaluated on that? Or is your peace found in Christ? He goes on to tell us in this passage, not only is our assurance demonstrated by our peace, but he does talk about grace, right? Through him, we have also obtained access by faith into his grace. The very idea of grace is something you've heard many times. It's the understanding that it is a gift of God. Ephesians tells us that salvation is our gift from God. It's not something that you do, something that you can boast about. Matter of fact, in this passage, Paul says that we have access. The word access that he uses is really the word introduction. It's the idea that we have been introduced to God through Jesus Christ, and that salvation is ours because of the grace and the gift that he has given to us. So if we're going to demonstrate what we have of our salvation, it's not going to be out of trying to do good works or do good things in order just to satisfy someone. It's going to be out of the fact that we have peace and we understand peace and we have his heart of grace in our lives. Now, salvation as we know it and being secure in our salvation is always going to bring with it the character of Christ, right? That's why it demonstrates the character. That's why here Paul says that his endurance moves you to character. And your character is always going to demonstrate who Christ is in you. And your assurance of salvation is going to be demonstrated by what we do. That's how we demonstrate the salvation of our life. That's how we demonstrate that I am secure in who I am. Now, unfortunately, there are many who aren't secure in their salvation because oftentimes we feel like it's on us. If I do something wrong, then I'm no longer saved. If I do something wrong, I might fall from grace. And everything that Paul is teaching, everything the New Testament, I believe, teaches us, that is not the case. Matter of fact, let's look at a verse in John chapter 10. In John chapter 10, verse 27, he tells us, I think, a really strong word. He gives us a lot in John chapter 10. It's Jesus talking. In John chapter 10, verse 27, he says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them. And," he goes on to say, "they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish." You hear how it's done, right? It's not like they might not perish, that something might happen. He says, "I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." When we demonstrate that kind of faith, when we live out our assurance, knowing that we are demonstrating the character of who Christ is in us, that's what he's asking us to do. That's why we are able to know with clarity, with certainty, that we have salvation in our lives as we seek to live out his character. Now, the third thing that Paul mentions in this passage in Romans 5 is the understanding of hope, right? He goes on in verse 3 to say, "not only rejoicing, knowing that suffering produces endurance, endurance produces character, and character produces hope." A living hope, just like we sang about. "And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts." Here, we begin to recognize that we have assurance of salvation that's found in the hope of this faith, a hope of your faith. Yet, the Bible teaches us that hope is not just, "oh, I hope this is going to happen," or "this might happen," or "I sure do hope we're going to have good weather," or "I hope I'm going to get this." It's not that kind of hope. It's being able to place our faith in something that we are assured of. Faith in something that we know to be truth. And that's what he's doing here. He's helping us as believers to know that we have assurance of heaven, of eternal life, because of the hope that we have placed not in ourselves, not in our own righteousness, not in the works that we do, but hope in the fact that he is the one who has justified us. He is the one who has made us right with God. He is the one who has brought us into right relationship. And once we recognize that, even when we struggle through the things of life, when we go through those times when we fall, it allows us to recognize who he is and who we come back to. A great illustration, I think, is to be able to recognize the difference in the Bible of a man named Judas, who was a disciple of Jesus, and a man named Peter, who was a disciple of Jesus. You might remember in that illustration that there was a point when Jesus told Judas that he was going to betray him, and he responded to Judas, "Whatever you do, do it, go quickly and do it." He also told Peter that he was going to deny him, that he predicted both of those denials, but he told Peter in his denial that he was going to deny him, and he said to Peter, "When you come back to the brothers, be able to strengthen them." Now, in those two illustrations, we began to recognize and understand by other scripture that Judas, though he was a follower of Jesus, though he was with him, though he was around him, he had never come to a place where he had come into a right relationship to trust Jesus as one who was going to justify him and give him eternal life. Peter, on the other hand, had recognized that. And so after Peter's denial, what did Peter do? He came back to Jesus. He came back to say, asking the Lord for forgiveness. Now, the question that I asked earlier, how do we know those people around us who are lost, who are saved, who say they were saved, who might have come to church and been baptized, but somewhere they have just fallen away and they are have fallen away? John would say, if they don't come back to us, in his gospel, his writing, 1 John, he would say, if they don't come back to us, they were never one of us. It's when they come back to us that allows us to recognize that salvation as we understand it is the work of the Lord. And we know that it is centered in his word. It's his word that we stand on. It's his word that tells us we can't go on feelings of those around us. We know that we are centered in his word. And his word teaches us through many different scriptures of who we are in him. I remind you, 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 23 says, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, by the word of God who lives and abides forever. The word of God, living and abiding, brings about new birth. Jesus talked to Nicodemus about new birth. And he would say that once we are born again, according to these passages, we can't be unborn again. That's who we are. We are now in Christ. He would also tell us not only are we centered in his word, but we are centered in the worth of who Jesus is, right? So when you look at Romans chapter 5, he's talking about the love of God. In Ephesians chapter 2, but God being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive. Now, in that passage, if we were to spend time with that passage, you would see that because he made us alive, we can't be made dead again because Jesus has done the work to make us alive. So in that life is in Christ because of his rich mercy. By grace we have been saved and raised up with him and seated with him in the heavenly places of Jesus Christ. Oh, friends, there's so many Bible passages that teach us about security of the believer, about eternal security, about the fact that when we are saved, we are saved into eternity because we don't save ourselves. We are not the one who have done the work because Christ is the one that we find that he has the one. And not only is he worthy, but he really is the one who has done the work. He has done it. It is his salvation, his gift to you. And you can leave this place with an assurance. You can leave this place knowing that when you come to Christ, you are in Christ. There are times when we fail. There are times when we mess up. But thanks be to God that he tells us that he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That's who he is. And then you ask the question, well, what about those people, those friends, those relatives, those people that I work with or hang out with who said, yeah, I used to be a Christian, but I'm not anymore. How am I supposed to respond to them? Well, I'll tell you how I respond. Because it's true. It's true in my family. It's true maybe in your family. It's true with my friends. It's true with people I've known for a long time who have lived out a Christian life but have now gone a different path. My response, what can I do? I can pray for them. I can pray that God would do something in their lives to do either one or two things. He will either bring them back to where they are in their salvation, or they will be saved. That's all I have. That's all I can do for a friend, a loved one, somebody I care for, is just beseech the Lord. Beseech the Lord that he would work in their lives in such a way to point them back to himself. If they were followers of Christ, I fully believe that he will do that. I fully believe that he will bring them to a place where they will recognize who he is in their life and they will come back to them. If they're not followers of Jesus, my prayer is that they will become a follower of Christ. That's why we pray for lost people. That's why we pray for people who are far from God. We ask the Lord to do a special work through who he is. So I conclude with this. When you look at the last phrase of this passage, he tells us at the end of chapter, well, the end of verse 5, hope does not put us to shame, but God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. The last thing I can say today to us is we have assurance of salvation because the Holy Spirit lives in us. Because Jesus said, when I go away, I'm going to send another one that's going to comfort you. The Bible teaches that he seals us, that he guarantees our salvation. There's a great passage in 1 Peter where he tells us that we are guarded. Our salvation is guarded in Christ by the power of God, which is by the work of the Holy Spirit. So our prayer today is that you would be able to leave this place. You would be able to turn off the computer. You'd be able to walk out of your house or out of this place saying, I know my salvation is in Christ. Yes, I may have messed up. I may have done things wrong. I may fall, but I know that God's love is so great for me that he's a God who forgives and cares. And yes, I know that I need to be a person who surrenders and becomes obedient unto him. My hope is that we would also go out of this place praying for those around us, praying for friends, family members, coworkers, others around us who need to recognize that eternity is real, that there is a view of heaven and hell that is real, and our desire is for all of them to spend eternity with us in heaven. Would you bow your head with me right now as you pray? I'm going to ask you to do that right now. I'm going to ask you to pray for someone that you know, that you know that has struggled, that you know that would say that, man, maybe they have walked away from their faith, they've walked away from the Lord. You have a name, you have somebody that you know in your family or coworker right now that you would just pray for them. You would say, Lord, let me, talking about you, live the kind of life of character in front of them that they may see your good works. And if they're not a believer, that they may come to you. If they are a believer, they may come back to you. That would be our prayer. My second question is simply for you. Do you have the peace that when you leave this time together, you'll be able to say, I know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm spending eternity in heaven. That is not something you know. We'd love to talk to you about that in a moment when we pray, when we sing. We'll have folks here to pray with you and just walk you through an understanding. We don't want you to leave any place, any time, without the assurance that you will spend eternity in heaven. Eternal God and Heavenly Father, we give you praise. We give you thanks. Lord, we ask that your Holy Spirit work in a way right now that only you can work. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Will you stand with me as we sing, as you might want to come and pray.